Well, you know, the main mitzvah, commandment of Purim is what? Is to read the Megillah, is to read the story of Esther in the writings, you know, and to read it in publicly, that it, is the optimum way of doing it. At the very least, reading with oneself from parchment. That's the way the Jewish community is supposed to do it. But the idea is to publicize the miracle of the fact that God worked through nature to save the Jewish people from destruction. I mean, that's the story. The story is that the Jewish people were there was a decree, right? There was a judgment. There was actually a royal decree of extermination, which was overturned due to some political overnight shift in things. Where there was a sudden, suddenly the king one day he said this, the next day, today he said the sky's blue, the next day he says sky's cloudy, total turnaround, like it was, you know, complete change, 180 degrees from one day to the next day. So, of course, we can find reasons for this. I mean, clearly, Ahasuerus thought he had reasons why he was changing his mind, and God placed those reasons in his mind. And we only get little hints from the Megillah as what have been his ulterior motive for making these changes. But the point is that the overarching picture is there that God saved the Jewish people through a hidden miracle, through a miracle in nature, through divine providence, things going on in the works with God behind the scenes. Right? So I think certainly it relates really to what's often referred to as the first commandment of the Bnei Noach, which is belief, which is not to believe in idolatry, which is to believe in the Holy One, blessed be, in his unity. And that's related to what the Megillah is really all about. And that way, it's the nations learning from the testimony of the events in the life of the Jewish people as a nation, as to the existence of God. You know, it's often said that, you know, from nature, human beings can learn that God is the creator of the universe. But how do we know that God is the judger of man and that he is the puppeteer of world events? That's from the Jewish people. You know, it's there's nature and then human affairs. How do we see God is involved in human affairs? That's from the children of Israel. That's how we see that he's involved in that as well. And that's really fantastic. I mean, that's the harder part. I mean, the first part is you look around at nature and you just see how incredible the intelligence and the awesomeness and the power. And you say to yourself, there must be a God. Someone made all this. Where is all this coming from? And all this energy and power and life and vitality. There must be some superior being, some superior force here at work. So that's an easier, but human affairs and the fact that human beings have so much choice, humans seem to be independent agents. So when we see, you step back and suddenly we see, wait a minute, you know, Pharaoh, 10 plagues, and then he let them out, and then he ran after them, and then they got lost, and then he was doused in the scenes. Oh, I see here, there's something going on here. This is a kind of orchestrated. You know, it's like I say every day, we say in the prayers that the enemy said to his people, we're going to catch them. I'm going to split the booty with you. Within the Song of the Sea, there is one verse there that talks about how the enemy, Pharaoh, you know, spoke haughtily and gloated, and he encouraged his people to come with him to pursue the children of Israel at the sea. And why is that? What is that doing there? How is that a praise of God? Why is that sentence there? That's not a praise. But that's what I think the answer is. I think that sentence is saying that, besides that, it's saying, oh, he wanted to do that and he failed and things went upside down and on his head. But I think the point is also, even that was God. Even the fact that he changed his mind and suddenly regained his courage and followed, like 10 plagues wasn't enough. He suddenly had doubted once again and thought maybe now is my opportunity. Why? How did that get into his head? Why, how come he wasn't broken and he didn't have enough and he somehow had more doubt? It's interesting that you see that even doubt is by the mouth of God. It's interesting. Doubt in God itself is God's own tool. You know, it's his own angels that cause people to doubt. And then we have to make a choice to ignore those doubts. I mean, is it the Zohar? I think gives the parable of the harlot trying to seduce the king's son, as the evil inclination is like a harlot. But the king sends the harlot to test his son. So in other words, the Holy One, blessed be he, created the evil inclination. He creates these doubts and so on. And so the wicked are completely orchestrated. They don't exert any self-control, and they give in unto all these things. So, I mean, it isn't surprising that Pharaoh followed, that once he was given opportunity to doubt and to find the courage to rebel against God, to try to assert the fact that he'd assert his power and his independence from God and that his own deification, that he took that opportunity to do so and was destroyed. So I guess my point is that even human actions, human decisions, which from one hand seem and should and are independent, yet God's working there somehow. You have another, and that's a lot more irrational than creation, because creation, as I said, everything seems to be following orders and orderly. But with man, it's, wait a minute, they're independent, but then I see you're not independent. Then it's like, you know, like, in other words, human beings seem to be make independent choices. And suddenly you say, wait a minute, that choice I made, how did I end up here? It's interesting. Why am I here and end up meeting you and doing this and making these decisions? And you realize, E.G., I'm here for a reason. How did this happen? And so that's an amazing, amazing thing. That's in a certain way more miraculous than natural events from a certain perspective. So anyway. So that's one aspect in terms of Purim. Getting back to the point of what I'm saying is that I think Achashverosh was manipulated. I mean to say, in other words, who put this idea in his head one moment to hate the Jewish people, or at least to, or at least not to care, to be completely apathetic. I mean, to the extent to allow in his kingdom the extermination of an entire people. And the next minute, He totally undoes all of that. So it's quite fascinating. Now, of course, you examine it, you can find reasons, and he suddenly finds out that the only minister that showed true loyalty was a Jew. So obviously that changed, that might have been a real game changer. His whole attitude changed. Then he finds out his own wife that he loves is Jewish. He didn't know that. So obviously those things end up changing his attitudes. But still, it's still incredible. And but what's also incredible is that Mordechai, Esther, and the Jewish people for all generations until the end of history see this as a miracle. That itself is a kind of a miracle. It also reflects the deep wisdom, spiritual wisdom of our sages and the leaders of those generations to see that. Because we go through life, the point is, very often we go through life and we don't see what's really going on. They saw it. And that was an incredible thing, that they had the wisdom and the faith to see what was really happening and to attribute it to God as they should, as opposed to attributing it to human ability alone. Just the opposite, they're attributing it to God, even though Mordechai and Esther, particularly Esther, played this really important role in the event. I mean, if she didn't concoct this plan, well, we just don't know what happened. But the reason why Achashverosh changes his mind is because Esther concocts this plan. And also because Mordechai did this act, because Mordechai was loyal to the king. These are the points that really changed Achashverosh's attitude. So this is really a key point for the B'nai Noach. And it runs through all of the Bible. Right, Ross? It's the point is that we learn from the children of Israel about God's providence and God, what God wants to teach all of mankind. And so that's one thing. There's another thing that I wanted to share with you, which I found fascinating in the Megillah, in the book of Esther. And that is the personality of Haman himself. I don't think I ever noticed it as much as this year, even though it's right there staring you in the face. But I just picked up on something that I found really fascinating this year, which is I read every year, but it never really hit me as much as this year. And that is that we have towards the end of, before Haman's demise, he's flying high. He's flying high before he falls all the way down. He's at the top. He makes this decree. He convinces Ahasuerus to make this decree against the Jewish people. He's the top minister. And not only that, the queen wants him and the king alone at a party. Nobody else but the two of them. He thinks he is the big cheese. Nobody like him. He is the top guy. Not Trump. He's the top guy. Nobody like me, he says. Nobody can do it like I can do it. Anyway, and what happens? So it says that, and he was feeling so full of himself leaving this party, the first wine party that he had with King Ahasuerus and Esther. And then he sees Mordechai as he's walking in the royal halls. And Mordechai does not get up and does not shake and does not at all respond to him in any way. Certainly not shaking and not afraid and shows no sign of reverence. And he's livid. He's livid. He's full of anger about this. He's unable to take it. And he calls together his advisors, his friends, and his wife. And he says, "I've gone all the way to the top. I have it all. You know, the queen calls no one to her party but the king and myself. Yet it's nothing. It still was nothing to me as long as I see Mordechai there." And the king, it's all worth nothing. I thought about this statement. I said, what is wrong with this man? He has everything. He's so rich. He's so powerful. And he sees this one Jew who does not affect by him. And it's all worth nothing. He says, it's worth nothing. Ain't no shovely. It's not worth anything to me. As long as I see Mordechai, I have to get rid of Mordechai. If I don't get rid of Mordechai, it's worthless. Why? I just thought this guy is such he's the biggest narcissist I've ever seen. I mean, it's unbelievable. His ego, and he was called Gas HaRuach, he's the most arrogant person I've ever heard of in my entire life. I don't think there's anyone this arrogant. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there are people like this, but we see an arrogance in Haman that is extraordinary. And an egotisticness, for lack of knowing the proper grammatical word for his behavior. I mean, it's so egocentric. And then I started thinking, I mean, the whole thing, it's so psychotic. How does the story start? He is this top minister. The tradition has it that he and Mumukhan, the minister who came up with the first idea to get rid of Vashti, is the same person. He rises to the top. Everyone's bowing to him. He's the top dog. And he's humped, but Mordechai won't do it. Mordechai doesn't give him the respect. He gets so angry, but he says, it's not enough for me to kill Mordechai. I have to kill his entire people. The people he said, he found out he's Jewish. That's it. His people have to go, not just him. Everybody, what kind of a sick mind is this? He has a problem with one person, and he says, that's not enough. I can't just kill him. I have to kill everybody, millions? What kind of a person is this? I mean, it's just simple in the words, but have you ever thought about it? How psychotic is this? How genocidal? I mean, but, you know, it's one thing to be a genocidalist and to have a theory and say, all these people are bad. I mean, it's crazy and sick. But you pretend to make sense. I mean, you justify yourself. Maybe that itself is a tremendous sin. But he has no justification. I mean, he's basically saying nothing. He's saying, I'm going to kill them because I can't just kill one person. What does he even mean by this? I can't kill one person. He seems to be saying, you know what he's really saying? He's saying, I'm embarrassed to admit that this little guy annoys me so much, I have to get rid of him. So I can't do that because that's embarrassing. So I'm going to make up some justification why I think his whole people have to go. Can you imagine what kind of a person we're talking about? So he's willing to murder millions because he has a feud with one person and he's too embarrassed that the king will realize that he really just wants to get rid of one person. That is, I've never heard of something so sick like that. It's incredible. I mean, what a psychopath. It's just unbelievable. But I think it's also so something so deep about psychology and human nature. Like, well, just the fact is that how we develop general attitudes about whole people, about when we interact with just a few. You know, and maybe that's part of it also. Like, he interacts with Mordechai and he says, you know what? They're all the same. Just get rid of, I hate them all. Let's get rid of all of them. You know, Mordechai is no good. They're all no good. Get rid of them. And then he starts. He comes up with this plan of how to get rid of everybody. So think about it. So basically what he's saying, what the Megillah, the storybook of Esther, is telling us, Haman couldn't have gotten away with killing Mordechai just by saying, hey, king, you know, this guy has no respect for me. I want him killed. No, that wouldn't have worked, evidently. Evidently, Pharaoh had the right to kill, and he would need to be convinced. Explain why he only wants to kill one person, and this one person is a royal employee of some kind. He's some kind of minister, advisor of some kind, maybe a low level, but he's there. So because he can't do that, he develops this whole rationale about all of the people of Mordechai, why they're all no good and why they're bad for the kingdom. In other words, he has to come to Achashverosh with some justification of why the kingdom will be better, or the king himself will benefit from getting rid of Mordechai. But he can't, because Mordechai alone, he can't explain why he benefits. So he makes up a story about everybody. Or you could say that the reason is that in terms of the Jewish people, he can come up with something. Mordechai himself, he can't just come up with something only about him. I don't know, but that seems to be the point. He was saying that, I can't just get rid of him. I can't justify it. I can justify getting rid of everybody. So let's do that. I mean, that is so sick. The scripture seems to imply that he was an anti-Semite and an enemy of the Jewish people, but the verses don't seem to say that. The verses seem to say it's a personal feud between he and Mordechai that he then hands to everybody. So again, it's just really this, it's such a lesson in human nature. You know, and maybe he didn't like Jews so much, but he wasn't willing to kill them. But this personal feud, that pushed it. That was it. He's really another, and you see this with people all the time. In fact, maybe there's some people who were B'nai Noach, who were thinking of converting and had bad experiences with the Jewish synagogue or something, and now they hate all, maybe. I mean, I think I've heard about, not individuals, but some kind of, but the point is, even within the Jewish community, okay, for example, sometimes you have somebody who has bad experiences in a Jewish school or something, and then he gets angry at religious Jews. You know, this is how people are, emotions. You know, that's your experience. So the person doesn't think intellectual, wait a minute, I mean, why am I generalizing? I had an experience, that's how I experienced it, but it's not everybody. I don't know it's everybody, but that's not how most people are. Most people have an experience and with a certain type of people, and they say, that's how these people are. And they blame everybody. Or they blame their beliefs. They blame the generalities about them for everything. They don't say, well, these particular people have problems. I think just in general, there's this tendency to blame religion I don't know if you found that, but I have, you know, people who about tshuva or ger or something, they become Jewish and they start and they have various problems. It's the religion. Maybe it's you. Maybe you have some issues you have to work out. I don't mean anybody here, but I'm just saying, you know, maybe you have some, maybe that person has some things they have to work out. Oh, maybe they're facing challenges that they need to face. It's got nothing to do with being religious. Maybe religious was a good thing because it made them face their challenges, which they were avoiding before. But in any event, this is what we see from the Megillah. The point is what we learn from it is to say, I guess the bottom line of what I'm trying to say about this is number one is arrogance, the danger of arrogance. You know, because that's one thing that Haman had in abundance. And Bilam also had it. A terrible, pretentious arrogance. And also greed. Right? And a power lust. But particularly this arrogance that it's funny because it's an arrogance with really inferiority complex. I mean, he's so arrogant, but one person who's clearly below his who's below his level on the hierarchy, he can't deal with it. Why does he say, who cares about Mordechai? Who's Mordechai? He's a nobody. I'm the big shot. I'm not Mordechai. So what does he care? Well, he can't take it. He can't deal with it. One person that doesn't give him the respect, everybody is bowing down to him. Just one guy does and he couldn't deal with it. You know, it's interesting. Again, psychologically, you see how arrogance is and being a bully is tied in with a lack of self-esteem. You know, I mean, that's really, Haman needed a therapist. I mean, seriously, he had a lot of psychological problems. So I think that's a tremendous thing to learn from him is to be far from arrogance. And to be humble, and to look away when people don't give us the respect that we expect and anticipate. Our expectations of respect from and honor from people should be not expected, or should we remain silent when we're in a position that we expect, and we may not always get it from everybody. Certainly, shouldn't deal with it. We generally shouldn't deal with it head on. And attack that person, find a way to deal with it indirectly. I mean, if we do need to do it, it should be done for the sake of the position and not for the person's own sake. In other words, for example, if someone is a teacher or a rabbi or something and they're being disrespected by a lay person, that might be bad for the teaching situation. That is something that, you know, it needs to be done for the sake of heaven. It needs to be done for the proper circumstances. We're going to take a 2-minute break for a moment. It looks like I have to take a short break. I don't even know if I can here. What does it say here? Stop video. Hold on. So we're back to a discussion. I mean, I'm not saying anything earth shattering here, but I think it's something some times that maybe I haven't been discussed about the book of Esther. Hello. And important really to think about. Very, very important to think about. It's interesting also, and another interesting point is after Haman faces a humiliation, the first one, in which Ahasuerus directs him to lead Mordechai in the streets and to say after him, so should it should be treated the man who the king seeks is to honor him. After that point, he returns to his advisors, his wife and his close confidants and asks them, and they tell him, if Mordechai is a Jew from the seed of Judah, then as you've begun to fall before him, you will continue to fall. And you will not get up. And it's interesting that they say that. And you wonder, how did they know that? And why did they say that? In other words, up until now, it's very strange because just the last episode in which he first consulted with them, they advised him to hang Mordechai. That was their advice. But now, when the tide is turned and the king is honoring Mordechai, they're telling him, you're lost. You're going to go all the way down. How did they know this? Anyone have any ideas?
I certainly don't, but I was glad that you brought that up because I was going to ask you about it to see if there was something I was missing.
Okay. Anyone have any ideas? Is there anywhere in the scripture that may be our clue as to where the advisors to Haman got the idea that once Mordechai begins to prevail, then you're lost? Where do you think they got that from?
Was it astrologers? I was reading a bit of the Rabbah about Esther, and they brought up a lot about like consulting astrology, but then they were only seeing in part. So that's just my guess.
Possibly. I mean, I have another theory, but it's not from the Midrash. It's just from my own deduction, and it could be wrong. But and that is that they were familiar with the prophecy that was given to Rebecca, in which she was told that that she was told that the nation, one, they will kind of wrestle with each other. When one, as our sages say, Zek comes and when one rises, the other falls. That when it comes to the eternal battle between Esau and Israel, when one rises, the other falls. So that's what they were telling him. They said, since we see Mordechai is rising, you're going to fall. Because that is the nature of the order of the world. When one rises, the other falls. And since it clearly was Achashverosh was raising up Mordechai, that means that Haman's time is going to continue, his downfall would continue, which is what happened. So that's my take on it, that they were familiar with that prophecy. It's interesting that Haman had a lot of sons, and there's a lot of talk about that. Time and time again, he's mentioned, well, first of all, in terms of his success, he's mentioned about his wealth and also Rov Banav, his many sons. And when the war takes place, when the Jews take vengeance on their enemies, we count those sons. And that's fascinating. Again, I don't have an exact answer for, I don't have a mystical answer for it this evening. But although I think there's something there mystically in terms of the different shell and impure force that Haman represents and his son represents, kind of offshoots. But it's interesting that even Haman was not a proponent of not having children. He had a lot of kids. He had a lot of children there. He had 10 sons alone. He's not even counting how many daughters he had. This guy had like 20 children or something. I don't know. Maybe he had a harem. Maybe he had more than one wife. I wouldn't be surprised. He was extremely wealthy, obviously, at this point. There are midrashim that talk about Mordechai having a very long, and Haman having a long history previously. But we don't see anything in the scripture that alludes to that. We do see There is clearly an allusion, and the Pythons talk about it, is that Haman was a descendant of Agag. Well, the verse says he was in a descendant of Agag, the king of Amalek. Right, he was an Amalekite, and Mordechai was a descendant of King Saul. This is clear. I mean, this is no question. So we see a continuation and a kind of a kind of closure here. There's a closure, you know. And what's incredible also is, you see, look at this, what happened here. Saul has compassion on one man, right? All of Amalek, they massacre all of Amalek, but they save the king, one person, right? So that's interesting. He also saved the livestock. Now, Haman does kind of the, well, similar maybe, or the opposite. I don't know how to really say it, but he doesn't have compassion. He has an issue with one. It's interesting. So Saul's commanded by God to kill a nation, and he has compassion on one man. He makes an exception for the king. Why they make an exception for the king is beyond me. I don't understand why him. They couldn't find like a poor widow there or something, an old lady. Why the king? I never really understood that. But anyway, you know, because if so, that also discredits his claim. I mean, I just don't understand Saul. I mean, the sages say that he was very disturbed by looking at the broken necked heifer. He said, "We concerned about, you know, one man's murder. So why is God ordering me to, you know, to execute and kill out a whole nation?" He didn't understand. He had moral problems, that he was disturbed by what he was commanded to do. That's one Medrash says this. But what I don't understand is, why did he then save the king of all people? I mean, the king was not a nice person, as we see from what Samuel says about him. It says, your sword, you know, murdered many people. So why did he save the king? It's very unclear why they saved the king. I don't know why they saved the king. Maybe because the king doesn't, you know, fight them. So they don't want to kill him without a fight. I really don't know why he decides to save him out of everybody. It's never explained. But in any event, this is what they do. For some reason, Saul takes pity on the king. Maybe it's simply because everyone was protecting the king and the king was the last man. And after killing so many people, maybe he was just exhausted from all the killing and decided, we're not going to do anymore. Or put it to you this way, maybe it was symbolic of having some compassion. In other words, I think what Saul, one of the problems he had is that, you know, if we do this act completely and we don't exercise any compassion, that's a very dangerous thing. So he wanted to have compassion on somebody. Again, why he would pick this man, I don't know. But it seems counterintuitive to pick the king. But in any event, that's what he does. And so the tradition says, look at this. Saul has compassion on him, and his descendant has a fight with one man, and he has no compassion on the whole nation. So Saul, you know, is grappling with compassion. And what's the result? The result is the descendant of Agag wants to murder the whole nation. So here's another lesson, which it's a little hard to accept, but yet we see it, is that don't be smarter than God. In other words, Saul was bothered. He couldn't understand, why are we doing this? And yet history explains it all. God says, don't let one of them alive. Okay, so what does Saul do? He leaves one alive. So you think one person, what could one person do? How could one person, in other words, if the Amalekites are a threat to the Jewish people, that they're the arch enemy of the Jewish people? Okay, but one person, what can one person accomplish? How can one person really harm the Jewish people, right? And yet that's exactly what happens. One person, generation later, almost exterminates the entire Jewish people. So in other words, when God said, kill all these people because they are my enemies and therefore your enemies, and they're a threat to you and a threat to my kingdom, wasn't joking. It actually comes out to be true. A few generations later, one man who is a descendant of the one man that they let live almost exterminates everybody. Unbelievable. Of course, our sages just simply say it's a lesson to show you that those who have mercy on the cruel end up being cruel to be compassionate, because that's what happened. He has compassion on this cruel person, and from that ends up that almost all the Jewish people who are good people are being, you know, are going to be murdered. So what he thought was compassion was not compassion at all. I mean, again, like the in Yiddish, they say, Don't be super smart. Seid's nicht größere Chochem wie Gott. That means don't be smarter than God. That's what basically Saul did. He's smarter than God. You think that you understand. You know, that could be our theory. Basically what Saul thought is, I'll kill everybody. But because even two people, okay, maybe somehow they can make a group. They could be a threat to us in the future. Because they're mortal enemies of the Jewish people and the Jewish God. But one person, what can one person do? What can he do already? Just leave it alone. He's a nothing. He's going to be a symbol of his disgrace. But that's not what happened. One person ends up having a grandson. They get so powerful and he's so full of hatred that he almost exterminates everybody. Unbelievable. So evidently God knew what he was doing when he said, get rid of all of them, didn't he? Yeah, it's hard to swallow because it's not the way we want to think. But this is what happened. This is what happened. His Saul's compassion on one man was the cause almost for the extermination of his entire nation. That's pretty heavy. It's pretty heavy. And again, it does show the point that what looks to you like cruelty, don't be smarter than God. Don't be smarter than God. You think it's good. And usually you'd be right if you're making your own decisions. But if God gives you a decree and says, this is what you must do, don't be smarter than God. It's not the usual situation. Usually you would be right. That's not the way we do things. But if God says, this is a people who are my enemies, and you must eradicate them, don't question it. When a prophet tells you to carry it out, you think you're smarter, you think you're going to bring peace to the world because you're better than God? You won't. You're going to bring destruction. And that's what he did. Saul's compassion brought destruction. If not for the fact that his descendants brought closure to this whole issue by killing Haman and his sons, it wouldn't be over. And evidently, it's still not over because we continue to remember Amalek. So somebody must have survived somewhere. Why do these people hate the Jews so much? I don't know. And that was the original question too. Like, why does Amalek come and fight the Jewish people? What do they have to do with anything? Maybe that's why God hates them so much. You have nothing to do with this. Where are you coming? Why are you attacking? When the children of Israel left Egypt and they crossed the sea and all these miracles happened, first thing is Amalek comes and attacks them. Why? What do you have to do with this? Why did they come? Why did they attack? Well, it seems clearly that they did it as a symbol of rebellion against God. They wanted to show that, oh, the God of the children of Israel, he does miracles, he can defeat the powerful empire of Egypt. We'll show you he's not so strong. We'll fight them. You'll see. We can do it. And that created a confusion because, well, think about it. They basically cooled off. And that's what our sages say. They cooled off the waters. In other words, there was kind of like this worldwide effect, political effect and cultural effect of people being afraid and being affected by these miracles. And realizing the Jewish people are special. They must have some special mission. Their God is special. We have to really respect them and listen to what they have to say. And obviously, the children of Israel, on all their messages, one God and freedom and morality and all these things, were so important if they would have been respected. But what happens? Amalek comes immediately. They make war with them. And so what does that do? They're not invincible. The children of Israel are not invincible. They can be beaten. And that cools down everything. So basically, Amalek, in fact, is God's worst enemy because he comes along and just when, you know, there's like this buildup of positive, collective, you know, persuasion towards Judaism, so to speak, towards monotheism and, you know, ethical monotheism in Judaism, he comes there and says, no, there's nothing special over here. Nothing to see over here. They're just like everyone else. They can be beaten. There's nothing here. So he's really basically the worst type of rebel and the worst type of enemy. Because what I'm saying is, not only is Amalek trying to kill the Jewish people, he hates them and wants to murder to cause physical harm, but he causes ideological harm against God. He's trying to show that God is just like the God of any nation. Sometimes he wins, sometimes he loses. He beat Egypt, but we can beat him too. And that really ruined everything. So I think mystically, you know, they say that one of the things that Amalek represents is the power to mock, to make light of God and serious and Torah and serious things. And that's really what it is. That's what they did. There was this, you know, again, like I said, the children of Israel get out of Egypt, the greatest empire in the world through miracles. Wow, the whole world is talking about it, right? The sea is split. The army of Egypt drowns in the sea. The whole world is talking about it. What is this and what does this mean? Wait, Israel is beaten or Amalek fights with them and their captives are taken. Wait, confusion. They're coming in there and they're bringing in doubt and they're, you know, it's like a teacher in a classroom is giving this amazing speech and the kids are really inspired to learn. One kid starts making a joke, cools everything. All of a sudden, the kids are laughing. The whole thing is stopped. The whole energy was going on, respect for the teacher. He messed up everything. That person is a problem, a very, very serious problem. And that's what Amalek is.